I've always been a fan of hardcore punk. So when you look at punk rock music, there's like kind of different branches of the tree. The hardcore kids is a much heavier thing. It was almost like living in between fast punk and fast metal, but there'd be these big grindy parts. So what happened after that, though, was this kind of post-hardcore movement where you didn't need to be screaming all the time and you didn't need to be super speedy all the time. You had the melodic stuff from the punk rock kind of that you loved and grew up knowing, but it was done in a much more adult, darker, or more aggressive way. And that really resonated with me. So I instantly was like, well, how do I do that? How do I go from writing really catchy, fast guitar riffs to something, much more heavy? And the first song on the record was a song called All Systems Go. And that song was the first one that Boxcar Racer wrote. And we said, holy shit. We're really on to something with this. The riff was started out with something that you might think Blink would do, where it's going. It was just this kind of drony thing, but then this fill comes in and it goes. And then it sunk down into these verses that were like super kind of groovy. That to me was like, okay, this is what really interests me. So what we did was a lot of it revolved around drum sets. We would record the big heavy guitar parts with these big drum sets, and then we'd come down to the verse where it's quiet. And we did this one little mic on a little drum. So it was tiny drums to big drums, tiny guitar to big guitar. So when you listen to the Boxcar Racer record, it's so dynamic. It was really cool because I felt that we were doing something that was really unique for the punk scene, really unique for my kind of songwriting career. There was an art form, there was a craftsmanship of that record. The recording process, it was crafted to have dynamic change and unhindered emotive potential. I learned so much from that. That's really what changed my entire perception of what could happen on a Blink record. We came out of that and we moved into the Untitled record, which is kind of the more famous Blink record that we got. That's why there was such a transformation of the band. I went away to college, and I came back and said, I've been illuminated. I have some ideas. This is where we can go. And by no means was it just me. I just think that I know for what I was responsible for, I was able to completely transform and give a lot more to help at least, be a spark to start the fire. But I think everyone on that record specifically was feeling that's what was needed, and in their own way, everyone brought that to the table. This is just on my story. That's the quantum leap with, a lot of those songs and tonalities and ideas and all that kind of shit. It came from that experience in Boxcar Racer. There's a whole second side of the Boxcar Racer story. So we're doing the record and I need someone to play drums. I called up Travis because he's a buddy and he's a friend. And yeah, okay, so Travis comes in and plays it. Well, it turns out the record's pretty fucking dope. And then we're like, well, shit, we should tour it. And then what we didn't think through was the way it may or may not look to the band of Blink. Because I think people were so passionate about Blink and the press starts to get weird, like there's some rift in the band or we're trying to start a new band. It wasn't any of that. It was like we just painted a painting and wanted to show people the painting. So coming back, after that, there were insecurities and issues within the band. And that started this long path of awkwardness, something that was totally benign. And making a dumb phone call to one guy to play drums created a lot of weirdness and, suspicion and conflicts politically, you know, within the band. And it wasn't meant to be that way. So, but at the same time, I think everyone was definitely realizing, though, we were still doing our best shit we ever did. So I think it was really difficult emotionally. It's like, I'm really pissed at this whole thing. But yes, the music is way better. And we, you know, so it was a little bit of all that. But then it all came to a head where, you know, it just didn't seem like the same band anymore for me, with all the awkwardness and suspicion because of Boxcar Racer. All of us overworked and exhausted because I should have just taken a fucking break. You know, I probably shouldn't have written another record. You know, I now am a father and I'm starting to miss that San Diego lifestyle, the sunset and the beach and laughing and beach cruisers, having fish tacos and laughing and seeing each other all day long and, you know, and having like a life, a neighborhood life in the best place ever. I didn't have any of that. And I'm looking all around me and I don't even recognize my band members. And I don't even know if I recognize myself, you know. I took the chance to walk down a completely different path, which was like, you know, it was the hardest thing I've ever done. But my God, I found myself. I completely found myself. Blink 182, you know, it started literally with these two things on Cheshire Cat. You know, that's all I used. It's funny because on the following album, Dude Ranch, this guitar moved over to this head. And what I ended up doing was using both of these amps. But then when I went and did Boxcar Racer, I felt like this was like tiny. I felt like this was more of a like a violin on a 6'4" dude. I put this here, and this is the guitar that started my change, where that was cool. There was so much more craftsmanship in this guitar. It's a semi-hollow body, so it has a fuller tone, and it feels more like an acoustic where you feel the guitar vibrating, but it was bigger, and it felt like a work of art in itself. So once I decided that that's what I wanted to play, I got my own model. The whole chocolate brown, the racing stripe, is kind of retro, it's kind of thrift store. It sounded great in the studio, it sounded great in a live show, it sounded incredible playing these 1052 strings. But after a while, I realized that I didn't like how glossy it was, I didn't like how new it was. So I got rid of just having a normal paint job, and I started spray painting my own guitars and burning it. But you got to be careful, because when you light this on fire, the paint will like, it'll explode. You have to be professional at vandalism to get this effect. It just looks fucking cool. Looking cool is like 90% of all music. It might even be 93%.